Well, hello and welcome to the final installment of our COVID edition of Symphonic Literature. Today we're going to turn our attention to the Dean of American Composers, Aaron Copland. The distinctive sound that you heard, the opening music there, a little excerpt from a one-page thing that he wrote for Life magazine called Down a Country Lane, later orchestrated. Beautiful, characteristic sound that we recognize as uniquely American and uniquely Aaron Copland. This is really the only composer that we've talked about from the United States. And I think it's important to understand that classical music, the great orchestras of Europe were formed relatively close in proximity to the great orchestras of the United States. The development of individual performance levels, of a national school of composition and approach to composition were much later to develop, but many of the great institutions go back well into the early part of the 1800s, the Boston Symphony, New York Philharmonic as we now know them. But really outside of Dvorak coming to the U.S. in the 1890s, we haven't really talked about the U.S. at all. Well, Copland, who would live from 1900 to 1990, I think is representative of how many of us ended up in music. He was raised not in a particularly musical household, in Brooklyn, a Jewish family that believed it was important for all of the children to study music in some form, whether it's taking piano lessons or violin, attending public school and reinforcing that with some additional studies outside. And so it was about the age of 15 that he actually decided that he wanted to become a composer. With many of the great Western composers that we talk about, the decision was made much earlier than that, or at least they had the advantage of significant training from a time much before then. Copland set off by taking some the term is correspondence classes. Today, it would be sort of like taking a YouTube lesson on harmony or theory or counterpoint. Learn to do it by mail, essentially. After some efforts with that, he ended up getting lined up with a teacher by the name of Reuben Goldmark, who was a very traditional teacher of Germanic values, studied form and harmony, German classicism. And he did this from 1917 to 1921. So from the age of 17 to 21. It's very convenient with him being born in 1900. And over the course of that time, he would remark later on that as a result of studying with a proper teacher from the beginning, he got to avoid a lot of the floundering around and mistakes that a lot of young composers would make. And it was at a point where he brought him sort of an experimental work where Goldmark looked at it and said, I don't even know what to make of this, that Copland realized maybe it's time for me to pursue studies somewhere else. And at this point, and this to some degree has changed in the last 50 years, but maybe not all that much, there was a sense of in order to be finished in your training as a musician in the United States, you were going to need to make your way to Europe. And of course, the Europe of 1920 was coming off of World War I, and therefore Germany was very much not in vogue as a destination, but Paris was. So it was off to study with Paul Vidal at the established conservatoire in Paris, but he kept hearing a name, and the name was Nadia Boulanger. And this is probably one of the most important figures to have at least some understanding of from the beginning of the 20th century. Nadia Boulanger taught at the conservatory, but is primarily associated with the American school in Fontainebleau in the vicinity of Paris. And of course, this is the Paris of the Roaring Twenties, the Paris of Chagall and Picasso and Sartre, Hemingway, I'm sure was kicking around there, and American jazz. And Boulanger had a massive studio of composers, as many as 40 different people. And I think the thing that is so amazing about Boulanger is that no two composers of hers, no two student composers of hers, sound remotely alike. She had the ability to help a composer identify their own inner voice. And with Copland, that had to do with connecting some of this formal training that he'd had, sort of Germanic school of training, with some of his natural inclinations and interests, American jazz, eventually folk melodies, these sorts of things. And so it was under her tutelage that Copland really grew as a composer. And one of the things that he talked about his time with her was just how eclectic her interests were. I've read stories about they would have dinner at her house, and she would pass out motets by Gesualdo, just bizarre sort of Renaissance era composer, and people would sing through them together, but also interested in jazz and a host of other things. And she was ready, willing, and able to help a composer flourish and find a new language. She was prepared for vile dissonances or something along those lines, was referred to. So in 1924, she was commissioned or brought to the U.S. to do a series of performances. She was also a very fine organist and a composer, though I know virtually none of her works. And Serge Koussevitzky, with the Boston Symphony Orchestra, wanted her to perform with the orchestra, also Walter Damrosch in New York. And she insisted that Copland write a work that she could perform. And the work that came out of it was the Organ Symphony. This is a piece, 1924, I believe, and it was concertized at major American orchestras. Walter Damrosch famously said, if this man can write a work like this at this age, then within 5 years, he'll be ready to commit murder. And I don't know that he conducted another one of Copland's works in his life. He certainly didn't write about Copland anymore after that. But the piece was successful, and Copland entered into a new phase of composition. And I think there is a good point to maybe put the brakes on for a moment and pause and stop and think, when we listen to Copland, the Dean of American Composers, what sorts of things do we expect to hear? Let's listen to something. Thank you. So that's the famous and beautiful opening to Appalachian Spring, Appalachian Spring, depending on how far north or south you are. And that piece was written in 1944 as a ballet for Martha Graham. Original title was Ballet for Martha, and as I mentioned in the slides, while we think Appalachian Spring referring to time of year, it's actually referring to Appalachian Spring, source of water, and the charming tale of a young couple who builds a house. This is the sort of music that we equate with Copland. It's this slow harmonic motion, beautiful open melodies. I say open meaning that it tends to be characterized by a lot of large leaps. Simple harmonies that may actually just be open intervals, open fifths, or major tonalities, but really quite beautiful. And it's very evocative of vast spaces. And this piece comes from right in the middle of Copland's most famous compositional period. Now, people like to divide Copland into a variety of different phases. We have the student jazz period, or maybe it's eclectic, and later on we'll get to those. This middle period ranged from 1936 to 1949, and I know I'm going a little bit out of order here, but it's for a good reason. So this phase we refer to as his nationalistic or patriotic or functional pretty period of composition. And almost all of his famous works come from this time period. Appalachian Spring, Rodeo, Billy the Kid, Outdoor Overture, Fanfare for the Common Man, a host of film scores, Red Pony, and as well as El Salón Mexico, I think I already said Outdoor Overture, Lincoln Portrait, works that are commonly associated with the vast expanse of America, and also maybe some patriotic ideals. Copland himself was not a particularly patriotic individual, and he was not a political person at all. I'll touch on that when we get to the Third Symphony later on. This is also a time period where he set a number of old American songs, folk tunes, that he orchestrated beautifully for voice. And so it's this Copland that people typically anticipate when they go to see a program that involves work by him. But I'd like to point out that maybe not all of Appalachian Spring, is quite as beautiful as that opening. In fact, there are some spots that sound like this. So in the ballet, once the couple's built the house, we have problems with fire and illness. And, well, Copland needed a little different language for that. And so you get something that has a lot more dissonance, has a lot more drive. I think it's a lot more angular. Okay, it's a very different sort of sound. And to this, I would say, we have to remember that as much as Copland loved the outdoors and seemed to capture the American pioneer spirit with Appalachian Spring, this was also a kid that grew up in Brooklyn, surrounded by skyscrapers of glass and cement and concrete. And I think we almost always have a mix of those two. The proportions change, but as we listen to works by Copland, inevitably we find that. So when we break up his career into style periods, we have a student period or a French jazz period that ranges from about 1924 to 1929. So this is, he's studied with Nadia Boulanger, the mature works that come out of that, and then some additional works with some of the same inspiration. And then from 1929 to about 1935, he writes a very different sort of music that, that people refer to as being abstract or experimental. And many scholars believe that some of his absolute finest works actually come out of this. There's a set of piano variations, which is challenging to the unprepared listener. And there's also a wonderful short symphony. Now, this piece is almost never played. It's written for an orchestra of significant size. Large woodwind section. It calls for a heckelophone, which is a baritone oboe, and a host of other things. Small percussion section, not a lot of brass. But I want to play a little bit of the finale of the short symphony. This piece was written in 1932, and it came at a sort of a stylistic crossroads for Copland. He had just finished a work called Symphonic Ode, another sort of big sprawling work that we don't get to hear very often. And he decided to take a trip to Mexico. He actually had a couple of Guggenheim grants and visited Mexico frequently during the 30s, and was looking to find sort of a new direction. He also became good friends with a conductor and composer, Mexican composer, named Carlos Chavez. And he ended up writing this. This is the finale of the short symphony. So if this is not from the jazz period, and it's not from the Americana period, why does it have such interesting rhythmic drive, some sort of jazz inflection? It still has some tender open moments and some free use of dissonance, but he did that throughout. Interesting. I think when we try to speak in terms of these generalizations and time periods and carving people up this way, I think it tends to miss the forest from the trees. Copland represented all of these different influences really throughout his life. Now, the last period of his compositional period, his compositional output, goes from 1950 till 1990. Actually, he really didn't write anything once we got to about 1980. He had started to spend a lot of time composing, but then he also actually suffered from Alzheimer's for the last several years of his life. But his last orchestral piece is called Three Latin American Sketches. And this is an interesting work because it's two movements that were written very much during this Americana functional period. But the first movement he actually wrote in 1972, and it sounds like this. Interesting rhythms, sounds like maybe for a ballet, still has some folk melody ideas. Doesn't seem all that different in terms of character from things that we've already listened to. So we've listened to things from 1932 and from 1972 and from 1940s, okay? And we can see there's a lot of similarities throughout. Now, Copland turned to serialism, and some of the pieces are certainly quite thorny, but we always tend to find those characteristics of these tender moments, open melodies, open harmonies that are really sort of a byproduct of the voice leading that frequently are beautiful, but sometimes kind of jab at you a little bit with some dissonance. And so that's going to really bring us to the work at hand today. And that's his Third Symphony. And this was written in 1946, so this is at the tail end of this Americana period, and it was on a commission by Koussevitzky. Now, we've mentioned Koussevitzky with all of the Russian composers that we've studied so far, Stravinsky, Prokofiev, and Shostakovich. And Koussevitzky was deeply committed to new music. And so when his foundation commissioned this work in 1946, Copland, feeling a bit of the pressure to write a work for Koussevitzky and the Boston Symphony, maybe takes the things that he's already quite good at and maybe tries to embellish them a little bit with some of this heroic nature that we've heard from Shostakovich, some of the neoclassicism that we've heard from Stravinsky. And it brings us to a very different sort of piece. So we're going to listen to the opening of the first movement. This is the first movement of the Third Symphony, which is the required listening. It's the last time you have to put up with that. And this movement is actually a rondo. Now, it's a slow movement, which is a little bit unusual in the sense that for a slow movement, we don't typically think of rondo form. So it's going to hold formal areas of A, B, A, B, and A. It's going to be based loosely around E. And what I want you to pay attention to is this nature of these open melodies. The idea that the harmonies are going to be very linear, okay? That the way that he's written the individual lines is going to produce the harmonies, not the other way around. It sort of weaves a little bit of minor mode in on occasion. There's some fairly assertive dissonance in a few moments, but overall, I think you'd agree, this is really quite pleasant. This is the opening of the Third Symphony.
Thank you.
there's something quite powerful about that. Just kind of wells up in a beautiful way. So the second movement is actually the scherzo. And again, fairly neoclassical in nature. He has an introduction, and then that's followed by a scherzo, trio, return to the scherzo, and a coda. So really not all that different from, let's say, Bruckner. So one of the things that you'll notice is he introduces two thematic ideas right from the very beginning. I'm going to identify those with slides as A1 and then A2. As we go into the scherzo, he actually bases the scherzo mostly off of A1 with small uses of A2. It's a very American sounding work. It seems like something that maybe goes with a bit of a Western. And I want you to notice just how challenging these brass parts are. So again, that was a little bit of the second movement of Copland's Third Symphony. The third movement, which we're not going to listen to any of right now, but I would strongly encourage you to check out the whole work, follow the link below or find it in the Spotify playlist. The third movement is an arch form that has a theme and variations tucked into the middle of it. And it actually goes straight from the third movement into the fourth movement, where we find a bit of a surprise. So for those of you who have heard the work before, not a surprise at all. For those of you who haven't, might be wondering, what in the world is Fanfare for the Common Man doing right in the middle of the Third Symphony? Well, this was already an incredibly successful piece. He needed to build a successful big ending. Seems like some good material to draw from. So again, we start with a beautiful soft statement, and this is something that I think we tend to miss about Copland. For some of the bombast and large moments that this piece certainly has, there's these beautiful, simple moments, like when the clarinet appears with the shaker tune in Appalachian Spring. In the band piece Emblems, which is one of the loudest things you could ever listen to, there's four measures of just beautiful, tranquil music before the last sort of explosion. And it's something that we see this tender side of Copland, this kid that grew up surrounded by concrete and steel and glass. So that's going to bring us to the very end of this movement. That the fanfare serves as the introduction, and then he has a very proper neoclassical sonata form movement. And then for the coda, he brings it all together and leaves nothing out. So here's the very end of Copland's Third Symphony. So the last several vlogs, I've let the music do the talking for the very end. I thought maybe for today we needed a little bit of an epilogue. Difficult to believe where the semester has sort of wound down to. And today we've just sort of scratched the surface on music in America by taking a look at Aaron Copland. We've really just scratched the surface of what symphonic literature has to offer, what the past century has had to offer, what this country has had to offer. We've skipped over important things. Charles Ives, who was a maverick working away as an insurance salesman, writing great pieces and putting them in his desk drawer in Boston, and yet created the Fourth Symphony, which is a magical fusion of folk idioms, American folk idioms, with some real modernist ideas. We have George Gershwin with his wonderful incorporation of jazz and African-American ideas into classical music. William Grant Still, a great African-American composer in the first half of the past century, who wrote a series of symphonies with melodic material that actually precedes Gershwin and yet sounds just like I Got Rhythm. You have works written in the last 50 years. There was a European composer, Goretzky, whose sort of orthodox spiritual Third Symphony went up the pop charts at one point in time, in the 90s, I believe it was. And yet we've had powerful works by minimalist composers, Philip Glass, post-minimalists like John Adams. We've seen the emergence of great women composers, Ellen Taps Wilch, Joan Tower, too alive and flourishing today. So there's a lot yet to be discovered, and we don't know what the history books are going to look back at 50 years, 100 years from now, from today. But it's important that we understand it's a big world and continuing to grow. So I would like to thank you all for spending some time with these vlogs, and hope that in some small way this has been able to substitute from the classes I so wish that I could have shared with you all this semester. Best of luck, stay safe, stay well, and thank you.